problem. So she is a breadwinning woman, and she worked in remittance economy, right? So the, it is clear. So Nazi, yes, as she calls herself, she. So this is the part of the interviews which are illustrating what I just told you. Yes, her son is Garma, so he lived for 3 years in the family of the sister, which becomes the quasi, and the family became quasi-parents. So she felt very sorry for that, but this was the only survival strategy. But her life as a labor migrant was quite a precarious. First, it was informal economy. She worked at the families. And then she actually couldn't enjoy the social benefits of formal employment. Right. The second thing, that caring jobs are they are precarious. Yes. So I'm not going to give here the story of that. She has several jobs to survive. Five. She changes her employees. She's doing all kind of domestic work, but basically she's nanny and she is a cleaning woman. She used to work both in public and in the family. So this is all necessary to make needs. She was also using her sexual attractiveness as one of the resources to get more more money. Yes, so she was capitalizing on provisional diaspora resources because a lot of people who was helping were Kalmyk people. She's bilingual and she is really building up the network of Kalmyk people in Moscow. So she tries to establish good contacts, quasi-family contacts with her Russian employees and contributing to it a lot. She's looking for a husband and she tried several times to get married, and she, this is her dream because she considers her breadwinning strategy to be, I mean, imposed on her by the situation. And her dream is to get married to the Russian man and to have full citizenship rights in Moscow as a resident. Though she is legally Russian, she encounters constantly racist attitudes, especially in the beginning of her migration story in Moscow, because facially he is recognized as a migrant, right? So she's a Gastarbeiter, yes, and you have legal vulnerability. And she puts on herself in such a situation as self-exploitation. Very intensive work, day and night. Her health condition is getting worse because it's manual physical work. And to, in order to solve her health problems, he traveled back there to Elistar because there she has this safety belt and can easily find the good doctors. But also in Moscow, there are Kalmyk doctors who know each other, and so they give it, recommend, give advices, and they pay less. She cannot enjoy, because she is informal, in the informal sector of economy, she cannot enjoy the health certificate and public provision. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you read and I talk, it does not coincide often, so just enjoy, right? So she's selling her femininity, and I had to look more carefully to my data, because here you cannot see it, but she's saying that yes, I am socialized as a woman, and I am socialized as Kalmyk woman, who knows how to take care, who has special skills and special taste for being clean and to hate dirtiness. Yes. First she wanted to come as a temporal worker because her son is a student there in the academic college now, right, in the medical academy. But then she decided to stay as a permanent resident of Moscow. So she never wants to go to the formal labor market because she sees precarities also in this connection. Now she's approaching very soon the retirement age, but she won't have any retirement unless she uses her network in order to produce false documents, which is possible, and she will produce them in Elista. So she has double belonging, living in Moscow, surviving in Moscow, and actually using the safety belt from her native country, I would say. So, I have to emphasize again that she is encountering everyday racism and migrant phobia. It is not in her workplace, but it is in the apartment, in the place where she rents. She rents from one of her former employees, and it is a cheap house. It is a cheap rent, but the neighbors were especially rude for her and tried to kick her out of the apartment, explaining that they don't want migrants, that they don't want foreign migrants, they don't want Gastarbeiters because they're dirty, dangerous, because they're, it is the threat for their security. This is how they measured her. But then she all the time have to prove that she is relevant here, that she contributes, that she and she, that she is a Russian citizen. So she says that she feels foreign in her own country, and that's why she needs to develop special safety belts or security belts, using her resources and skills and capitalizing on them. So I just another one strategy is to solve all her economic and citizenship problem through the sexual and marital strategies. So to come to the conclusion, you know, this story tells us that she has to go through certain strategies of identity management. She is in the precarious situation, and she is not socially included by her, but her inclusion is precarious. And that's why she has to perform citizenship, to perform gender, to disguise her ethnic belonging and racial belonging by class performance, which means that she is overdressed. She demonstrates that she's well off all the time. She puts on large glasses, and her son is doing the same in Moscow, that they won't be treated as poor Gastarbeiters that people see as a threat for their security in Moscow. So, society is porous. Migration is what we live with. But the boundaries are in our heads. And the stories of migration are always the stories of precarity, and society is not very helpful in that. This is the conclusion.
Elena and Nati, they have taught us a lot about what Claudia was also mentioning before, our internal imperialist ways of ruling and governing populations. And I also want to mention something that yesterday Professor Vishwanathan said about being a refugee due to development. So I think that we have common issues here to talk later. So now we are having Professor Elaine Salo. Professor Elaine Salo is currently at the Institute for Women's and Gender Studies in the University of Pretoria. And she will talk to us about youth, masculinities and femininities. She is very concerned about comparative approach on Brazil and South Africa.
Thank you, Antonari. Thank you so much for the opportunity to present at this conference. And going to speak to ongoing research I've been conducting in Cape Town in South Africa. And I'm an anthropologist by training, but I work in the context of critical anthropology with a focus on policy. And my interest in youth is an attempt to use young people as an index to shifting, changing notions of citizenship in relation to understandings of inclusivity and exclusivity in the context of South Africa. I think Cape Town holds a very specific position in South Africa in the sense that I think it is the quintessential city that has embraced a form of neoliberal governance. And it has created, in that sense, increasing levels of peripheries, spatially or geographically, as well as in relation to identity. So let me start off by, how do I get this in a bit? Okay, I think in terms of studies, critical studies on youth in South Africa, a large sector of our population is under the age of 30. In terms of a definition, we work with young people between the ages of approximately 15 and 30 years old. Youth have been major players in changing the history of South Africa. They have been recruited for mining in the 18th century, and they are associated with the education uprisings of Soweto in the 70s that gave impetus to resistance to apartheid in the late 70s. Nelson Mandela himself is associated with a very critical moment in the history of the ANC with the refusal of the ANC Youth League in the 40s, for example, rejecting a more conservative notion of change. So young people have always been some kind of social barometer in the South African context. But I think in the contemporary context, they also indicate structural constraints and social issues, and they give us some indication of possibilities of new avenues of both social development, but also of senses of exclusion and exclusive citizenship. So let me just set the context. I looked at a literature review on contemporary